Okay, good afternoon, everybody. I hope you can all hear me okay. My name is Dr. Patrick Diamond from Queen Mary Marland Institute and Policy Network. It's my pleasure to welcome you here this afternoon. I'm going to make a couple of introductory remarks about the conference today, but before I do so, I want to make one very important announcement, which is about the fire alarm. If the fire alarm goes off, it's not a false alarm, and therefore you should make your way to the nearest exit. And if there is a real fire alert, then we're supposed to congregate in St. James's Park. I wanted to make sure I said all of that in case the Marland Institute gets sued or something. So if there's a fire alarm, it is a real fire alarm, and you must proceed out of the building by the nearest exit. Okay, so on to the substance this afternoon. It's my great pleasure to welcome you to this symposium on the intellectual and political legacy of Anthony Crosland, which is co-hosted by the Marland Institute Policy Network and the Foundation of European Progressive Studies. What I wanted to do in introduction was just say a couple of things about why we've decided to host this event today. Why have we decided that this is the moment to hold a symposium on the political and intellectual legacy of Tony Crosland? Well, I think there are two particular reasons why we were keen to bring together this event and all of the speakers who are here this afternoon. The first and perhaps most obvious reason is that 2016 is the 60th anniversary of the publication of The Future of Socialism. And I think it's fair to say that over time, this book has had a major impact both on the British left in general and the Labour Party in particular. And there are many, indeed, who argue that Crosland's book remains the most authoritative work of socialist theory produced in Britain in the 20th century. Now, of course, a book which was written 60 years ago cannot possibly offer a complete set of answers to the problems which the left confronts in our own time. But for all the flaws and omissions in Crosland's political and economic thought, The Future of Socialism is still a text well worth re-examining. And then I think the second reason for holding this event now is that the left in Britain and across much of the Western world is in a state of disarray. That might be the understatement of the afternoon. It's difficult, I think, to think of a time in the last 60 years in which social democracy globally has been in a worse position. And in the British Labour Party, social democrats now occupy a somewhat marginalised position. Centre-left parties across Europe are losing elections, not only to centre-right parties, but also, of course, to populists on the left and on the right. And events from Brexit to the election of Donald Trump in the United States do point towards something of a fundamental crisis of liberal social democracy, driven by the disconnection between economics and politics, and again, driven by the considerable backlash which has occurred against liberal globalization and all of the changes associated with it. So it's clear that the social democratic left is going to have to rethink its position from first principles. And I would argue that we can take from Crosland a restless determination to formulate a social democratic position which is both intellectually coherent and practically relevant to the world as it actually exists today. Of course, as I've already said, there are unquestionably weaknesses and problems inherent in Crosland's development of socialist ideas. But I think what stands out above all is Crosland's willingness as a political thinker to engage practically with the policies and politics of the times. And that's why, arguably, he remains Labour's great revisionist. So those are the thematic introductions to today's event. Let me just say a couple of words about the structure. There are going to be three substantive sessions in today's symposium. And the first will be a personal reflection on Tony Crosland's life, political career and intellectual contribution. I'm delighted to welcome Dick Leonard, David Lipsey and Giles, Radice, who will offer their reflections. Dick Leonard, of course, was Crosland's parliamentary private secretary at a crucial point in Crosland's career. David Lipsey was Crosland's key political advisor, both in opposition and in the 1974-79 Labour governments. And Giles Radice was a Labour Member of Parliament whose politics were strongly influenced by Crosland's revisionist ideas, and indeed Giles has written a number of important books reflecting on Crosland's revisionist strategy. Then in the second session, we'll have a further series of reflections on Crosland's intellectual legacy, centred on the themes of liberty, equality and identity, which Simon Griffiths, Sundar Katwala and I will address. And then in the final session, we have a roundtable discussion led by an outstanding panel of speakers who are going to reflect on the future of social democracy and the challenges that we face in renewing the centre-left today. So those are my words of introduction. Before we open the event formally, I just want to thank those who are really responsible for having organised today's event. In particular, Catherine Miller at the Mile End Institute, and also Catherine Roberts and Josh Newlove at Policy Network. I'd also like to thank each of you for coming and hopefully participating in what we expect to be a vigorous and lively debate. So with that, let me hand over immediately to Professor Jean Seaton, who's going to chair the afternoon's first panel. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much indeed. Beautiful, boyish, clever, charismatic, hedonistic, witty, controlled by a kind of seriousness and not taking it seriously, but taking it very seriously, bewitching, unless you found yourself a lesser person than him. Everybody fell for him, except for those that felt like Wilson, that he didn't like them. I think what we're going to start with is, and we're very, very lucky, a set of personal relationships to a politician of quite extraordinary particularity, with the capacity to charm his way, Anthony Crosland, through all sorts of ideas. So we are very, very lucky, it seems to me, to have three people who worked so closely with him and whose, as it were, political afterlives have also been so influenced by that working with, to look at some of the qualities and ideas that started with Crosland. We're going to start with Dick Leonard, who came first, as it were, a new Unionist, an ex-Labour MP, worked a lot in Europe, one of those sort of founding fathers of a kind of socialism that seems to have gone. Then we're going to go to David Lipsey, who was a political advisor and also worked very closely with Crosland at another moment in his life, I think, and has, I know, incredibly interesting things to say about the way in which that politics developed. And then we're going to go to Giles Radice, who in Friends and Foes...
Friends and Rivals.
Wrote a book that looks at the kind of competitive cooperation, really, between a set of extraordinary Labour leaders. All politicians are competitive and cooperative, but it was a very particular form of it. And Giles is going to finish this. So we're going to start, and then we'll have some questions from you. But I just want to say how extraordinarily privileged it is, actually, at this moment, to have these people who had that direct relationship to the kind of ideas that then follow later. So, Dick, would you like to start?
Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Jean. I'd like to start with an apology. That is, I'm going to read from a script. I'm doing this because I was very scared that I would go on and on and on if I didn't have this, and I've been told that there was a very strict timetable this afternoon. So here goes. I first encountered Tony Crosland in the 1950s when I was a keen young Devonite, and he was a leading supporter of Hugh Gates School. I started off with a distinct disapproval of him, but this did not survive the first two occasions when I heard him speak. The second of these was at a Fabian weekend school at Beatrice Webb House, the former trade union conference centre near Dorking, where Tony was to speak on the economics of nationalisation. Hugh Dalton was in the chair, and in the front row was Tony's beautiful new young wife, Healey, who looked up at her husband with rapt admiration, though I rather doubt if she took in very much of what he was saying. It was shortly after Labour's defeat in the 1951 general election, and the nationalised industries were extremely unpopular, partly because of the large losses which several of them were chalking up, but mainly because of the high prices they were charging their customers. The main theme of Tony's talk, however, was that these prices were far too low. They had mistakenly not taken advantage of their monopoly position and had supplied coal, electricity and gas far too cheaply to privately owned industry at well below world prices, enabling the private firms to make huge profits while the state-owned firms were in the red. Had they charged realistic prices, Tony argued, they could have raised sufficient funds to pay for the massive updating and development which otherwise had to be subsidised by the Treasury. Not being an economist, I had no idea if his argument was sound, but I was deeply impressed by his willingness to challenge what had become conventional wisdom and the brio with which he advanced his case. A few years later, I started work at the Fabian Society as Deputy General Secretary and soon discovered that by far the ablest members of its executive committee were three still youngish Labour MPs. They were the three men Giles wrote about in his book Friends and Rivals, Crosland, Jenkins and Healey. I quickly decided that one of these three was one day going to be the leader of the party. At the time, I concluded that it was most likely to be Healey, thinking that Roy was too shy and that Tony would be disdainful of making the necessary compromises that leadership involved. Personally, I much preferred Tony and we became friends, but not close ones. It was only after the 1970 election, when I was elected for Romford, that I got to know him very well. He asked me to be his PPS and said he wished to be able to talk with me together with total frankness, most specifically about his relations with Roy Jenkins, which these superficially were very good, but underneath, both were deeply distrustful of each other. I agreed to this and soon afterwards told Bill Rogers that I would be unable to attend further meetings of an unofficial group he was running, which was effectively the Friends of Roy Jenkins. This was made up largely of pro-European MPs, of whom I was certainly one, and it was Europe that drove Jenkins and Crosland further apart and occasioned the only serious disagreements which I ever had with Tony. I was one of the 69 Labour MPs who voted to stay in, and Tony, who was basically in favour of Europe, put party unity first, but could not bring himself to follow the three-line whip and actually vote against Europe and abstained in the vote. He thought I was mad to vote for, potentially putting my parliamentary career at risk. He was right about this, but I never regretted my action, as I would have lost all self-respect if I had acted otherwise. Crosland was heavily criticised by the pro-Europeans, who thought he was putting personal ambition before his convictions. I don't think this was true, at least consciously, but I do sometimes wonder if he would have voted differently if somebody other than Roy Jenkins had been leading the pro-Europeans. Sometime later, Jenkins resigned the deputy leadership and the shadow chancellorship in protest against the shadow cabinet's decision to back a referendum. Tony was at a conference in Tokyo at this time and was doubtful about running for the deputy leadership, but very keen to be appointed Shadow Chancellor. He asked me on the phone to go and see Harold Wilson and arrange a time when they could speak on the phone. Harold received me warmly and said he was available any time, but when Tony phoned him, he was very evasive. It transpired that Dennis Healey had already been to see him and had been promised a post. He was certainly less qualified than Tony, but as an elected member of the National Executive, carried more clout. So Tony ran instead for the deputy leadership, and in his absence, I had to start off his campaign. In the end, he came a respectable third with 61 votes, being eliminated behind Ted Short, who went on to beat Michael Foot in the runoff. I canvassed a large number of MPs on his behalf and was surprised to find a significant number who I had thought would be likely to be favourable to Tony, said that they were going to vote for Ted Short, but appeared extremely uncomfortable in telling me this, and were putting forward rather odd reasons for their choice. It was only many years later that I discovered that the Jenkinsites, about 40 or 50 of them, had held a secret meeting at which they had sworn all to vote the same way in the ballot, and in their own ballot produced a very thin majority in favour of Ted Short, but nearly all of them then went on to vote Short, and he was elected and made possibly rather less distinguished deputy leader of the party than Tony would have been. I remember in particular that both David Marquand and David Owen were amongst these members I had a conversation with, and they seemed very uncomfortable explaining themselves. Now, why did the Jenkinsites decide to vote for Ted Short? This was in the belief that he would keep the seat warm for Roy if he ever wanted to come back, but that Tony would hang on and become a serious candidate for the leadership. He did run in 1976 and came a dismal sixth, but Callaghan appointed him as Foreign Secretary, which for the first time put him in the top rank of contenders, and people began seriously to speculate that he might be the next leader after Callaghan. My view at the time was that for this to happen, Callaghan would have to carry out his apparent intention to swap jobs between Tony and Dennis, and for Tony to be seen as the more successful Chancellor. We shall never know, of course, if this was to be. Incidentally, as some of you know, I had lunch with Tony just 2 days before he had his stroke, which killed him a week later. And he said to me then he thought that Callaghan wasn't going to go ahead with this swap, which alarmed me. But he said he was rather pleased because he was beginning to respond with great enthusiasm to the challenges of being Foreign Secretary. Initially, he only regarded this as a consolation prize for not getting anything better. A little coda on the rivalry with Roy. I went to Brussels as a journalist in 1980, in the last year of Roy's chairmanship of the European Commission, and saw quite a lot of him. He and Jennifer came to dinner with us just before his term as commissioner came to an end. He was in a very relaxed and candid mood. He began by sketching out his plans for setting up the SDP. He asked my view, and I replied that it was an ill-conceived venture and that I certainly wouldn't join it, though eventually I did. He then started to talk about Tony and said how much he regretted that they had fallen out. It was purely by chance, he said, that he'd been chosen as Chancellor in 1967, and he could understand well why Tony had felt that he had the better claim. When he was at Oxford, Roy said, Tony was the great star and I was nothing, nothing, he said. He went on to say that he was certain that Tony would have been chosen as Callaghan's successor had he lived. I felt a strong sense that this had troubled him for a long time, and that he was grasping for a final opportunity to settle old scores and to bury the hatchet.
Thank you very much indeed. Very funny. Well, I don't know if we're going to go on being friendly rivals, but David.
Well, it's a great delight to follow my old friend Dick Leonard on this platform. I do apologise for arriving 15 seconds before Patrick stood up, but I'm afraid this vice of hyper-punctuality is one of the many marks that Tony Crosland left on me. When we went to Department of Environment, then in Big Towers in Marsham Street in 1974, I would get, as his special advisor, a call on the phone from the private office saying, the Secretary of State will see you in 2 minutes and 30 seconds' time. Now, this was quite difficult because the lifts were very slow in Marshall Street, which was 18 floors high. But I would do my very best and dash into the lift, arrive panting at the Secretary of State's door, and he would look at his watch and say, you are 17 seconds late, young man. Please don't allow it to happen again. The control of time was something we'll come back on. But to take time in another sense, this may be an obvious point, but the future of socialism was written 60 years ago. That is the gap between 1900 and 1960, which is an eon in political time. Tony himself died 40 years ago next year, nearly an eon in political time. In that time, most of the parameters affecting politics have changed. I mean, most notably in the case of our part, of the Labour Party, social class, which has completely changed and is no longer, anyway, the most viable political force. The only thing that hasn't changed, actually, is the left of the Labour Party, because Jeremy Corbyn is absolutely indistinguishable in his views and manner from the Labour left of those days. He could almost be someone of the Michael Foot or Tony Benn ilk from that day, which is probably why we're not doing terribly well in the opinion polls at the moment. I don't mind him being a lefty. I do mind him being so completely out of touch with the modern world, but that's another matter. I got in with Tony really in two stages. The first was that I was in Oxford in 1967 to 70, when, of course, the new left was in full flood, and the great men were Chris Hitchens and Tariq Ali. I very old-fashionedly belonged to the Labour Club of the day, which was still affiliated to the Labour Party, but I did get infected by some of that nonsense. And I can remember to this day sitting down one day in the library, picking up The Future of Socialism, and the eureka moment when I realised that this was a form of socialism to which I could relate in a way that theirs was a romantic nonsense not based in thought. And so I was already a Crosland addict at that time, but of course not working for him. And indeed, it was the sheerest chance that I ever did work for him, if I could just briefly relate the story. The Roundtree Trust, giver of money to good works, decided that shadow cabinet members, it couldn't be done through charitable money. They set up fellowships for members of the shadow cabinet to have assistance. And I was called in for interview by Douglas Houghton, then the chairman of the Parliamentary Labour Party, Pratap Chitnis, who ran the trust, and Roy Jenkins. And the interview went on for about 45 minutes with Roy asking most of the questions, you know, things like, do you enjoy Magdalen? Did you find the teaching there good? Did you like the architecture? And 5 minutes before the end, in came Tony Crosland, straight out of an all-night session of the bill on the Housing Finance Committee, the cheroot hanging off his lip, and clearly pretty well much the worse for wear. And he stayed for 5 minutes in my interview. So I was not that surprised when next day Roy Jenkins invited me to go round to his house for a second round of interview, which was going swimmingly. We had lunch at his house until he suggested croquet after lunch. Now, unfortunately, he rated himself at croquet, and he wasn't to know that so did I, having been school champion. And the interview would give them the lunch went terribly, terribly well with Lord Anne and, you know, classic Roy lunch, until I roqueted his ball deep into the flower bed. Anyway, I don't know quite what happened thereafter, but the next day I got a note asking me to go and work for Tony Crosland. Now, this only actually occupied 5 years of my life, from 72 to 77, but I have no hesitation in saying it was by far the most influential non-sexual relationship of my life. Extraordinarily powerful effect. He was, as Jean says, a singular man. There's just one thing I wanted to disagree with you about. He was not, didn't get cross with lesser men. He got on extremely well with the the people of Grimsby. He got on extremely well with people.
But they were heroic working class people.
No, not even them. He was perfectly happy with middle class people, so long as those people did not have pretensions to excellence that were not well grounded. What was not wise was to present yourself as an equal of Tony's when you were very far short of it. He couldn't abide that, and he didn't like people who pretended to be much more than they were. And so that, you know, is a difference of emphasis, and he did get on perfectly well with people who weren't from his background at all. He had a singular way of working. Dick will remember this. He had one of those Eames chairs. We're told they're not going to be available for sale anymore, but they were then. Expensive Eames chair on which he reclined. He'd have a very large pile of files at his speech, and at his feet, and he'd be absorbing the detailed policies. When I went round as his special advisor in opposition, yes, we'd have a chat, but I was expected to have a properly prepared agenda at the ready of the items that we're going to cover, which could be anything to why did he get a bad piece in the Times Diary to the future of socialism. And then Susan, his beloved wife, would prepare a delicious lunch of sandwiches. In the summer, we would sometimes be allowed half an hour to watch the test match after lunch, and then he'd say, right, must be getting on, and he'd go back to the Eames chair and continue. So this mixture of high seriousness and frivolity were always present and competing in him. He's the only politician I can imagine who would insist when Foreign Secretary that Henry Kissinger flew to an US base in Lincolnshire so that Tony would not miss a minute of the Grimsby Town match that Saturday. He was devoted to his football team, who I believe they're not even in the league now. Are they? That is the most exciting news I expect to hear this afternoon. Thank you for that. It's often said he drank plonk when Roy Jenkins drank fine claret. This is not true. He didn't drink plonk. He drank gin and tonic mostly. And you must remember, these are completely 60 years ago, it was completely 40 years ago, completely different times. Tony would have three large gin and tonics, and when I say large gin and tonics, I mean large gin and tonics, before doing parliamentary questions to stiffen his background. And he wasn't that far out from the rest of them. In fact, I was told that he'd moderated his drinking very considerably by the time I came to work with him. But it was a different way of working and a different way of politics. You didn't have to do 40 or 60. Media interviews every day. You had 40 gin and tonics instead. Not that we were any of the worse for it. It was a singular lifestyle. It was dependent very much on Susan. I'm told by people who knew him at Oxford that he was exclusively gay at that stage. I don't know if that's true, but certainly he wasn't gay when he had Susan. They had a what I suspect of being a somewhat exotic sexual relationship. Tony Benn would sometimes interrupt them on the job when he came round for a chat about politics on Sunday afternoon. If I single out the what strikes me about him in retrospect mostly, it is that he was a great man. Now, it's very difficult to define what a great man is, though if you are in the presence of one, you tend to realize it. And I don't like doing this business of saying how much politicians have declined, but I haven't had that feeling of being in the presence of a great man. Well, certainly since Roy Jenkins died, who I also became very fond of, but since Tony died, there aren't, I think, any examples. The other thing is that he was then possible to be, and he was, a great public intellectual, a class of person which has also been in decline. Perhaps Ralph Dahrendorf in this country is the last. Sorry?
David Markland, I would suggest.
I wouldn't be able to accede to that particular suggestion, but I think that I think that the supreme public intellectual is perhaps Daniel Bell in the United States, who's a great friend of Tony's, author of The End of Ideology. Quite major figures in the intellectual world, although not always academics. He was a great man. He wasn't a great politician because he was ambiguous about the art. And he, I think, probably grew more ambiguous as he went by. I mean, and there's some stuff recorded from the days when he was working with Gates Corps, where he said we must be prepared to resort to any shenanigan in order to defeat the left. Well, he wasn't a great shenanigan man as he got on. And he wasn't very good at the personal side of it. Funny enough, people call Roy shy and Tony extrovert, but if anything, I found them, when you got to know them, a bit the other way. And I can remember, Dick, you'll remember this, when he was running for the leadership, we sat him down with a list of phone numbers for members of the Parliamentary Labour Party, because they were the only ones with votes in those days. Ah, what great days. And he was asked to ring them up to canvass their votes. And we hear this conversation, here's happening, I'm standing across and here, just seems whether you can expect, I can expect your vote in the election. And they'd say, I'm afraid I don't know, Tony, we haven't made up my mind. I'm a great respecter and admirer of yours in many ways, but they're strong. And say, well, thank you very much. Put the phone down and said, put him down as a probable. he didn't really have the dedication that. The other thing I have to say, which is slightly negative about him, is I'm not sure he was a great minister. He might have turned into a great foreign secretary, but the trouble was that he was too cerebral. So when, for example, major thing at Department of Environment was housing policy, where he'd done all these weeks with files, and he set up a great housing finance review, which produced War and Peace every day of the week in terms of volume. But at the end of it, he decided it was all too difficult and decided to stick with existing party policy, which had really very little in logic to be said for it. He, as a minister, he's a good councillor. He cancelled Maplin. Yeah. He cancelled the Channel Tunnel. But he wasn't such a good maker of constructive policy. I think the best, nearest he came was the transport policy of 1976, which unfortunately he left DOE 3 weeks before it's published, and that document still makes sense as a transport policy, but he wasn't a great constructor, and partly he found it difficult to make up his mind without knowing too much, without knowing so much that he was almost paralyzed into indecision. I have to answer this question because everybody will ask it otherwise. Would he have become leader of the Labour Party? Well, I think probably not, for this reason, that, as I say, the vote in those days was confined to Labour MPs, and he was everyone's second choice. The party was largely divided between left and right. There was some centre ground, and both left and right had their preferred candidates, and so he was tended to be eliminated, as he was in 1976 on the first ballot. I regard it as a great fortune, both to him and possibly the Labour Party, that he didn't become leader. I think he would have found it agonizingly difficult to have sought to lead the party during the Bennite insurgency. I don't think he would have found it possible to find the language to do so. And although we had to put up with Michael Foote and all his shortcomings, he did in fact hold the party together. And I think, Tony, there would have been this combination of finding it impossible to hold the party, but suffering agony at the failure to do so, because he wasn't naturally an SDP man. Anyway, I think his legacy won't come in what he actually did politics, but in the future of socialism, in the conservative enemy, in socialism now, in the many, many Fabian pamphlets he wrote, and in the legacy of humanistic left-of-center thought that he left, which challenges all the lesser forms of thought that surrounds him. I don't think you can pick up the future of socialism and say, here is my manifesto. No book since the Bible has had quite that effect. But I think that when we debate the future, as we shall later on this afternoon, there are many of the ways in which Crosland thought and his mode of doing politics, which we should be wanting to give very heavy weight to in looking forward. Thank you.
Do you mind if I stand up?
No.
The reason I'm standing up, can you hear me at the back? The reason I'm standing up is otherwise I tend to cough. For some reason, if I stand up, I don't, or not very often. So that's the reason I'm standing up. I want to begin first by congratulating Patrick Diamond on his splendid book. It's an exceptionally lucid account of the legacy of Tony Crosland, and in my view, persuasively demonstrates the continuing relevance of the revisionist approach to politics. And Patrick, I'm confident that it will become a standard work. And so I urge you to buy this book if you haven't already done so. Now, when I first became involved in Labour politics, my three heroes were Tony Crosland, Roy Jenkins, and Dennis Healey, as you've just been hearing. And I think that they're probably true of all of us three. All of them gained firsts at Oxford. All of them had distinguished war records. And they were prominent supporters of the then Labour leader, Hugh Gaitskell. They were larger-than-life characters with extensive hinterlands, that word that was very wisely introduced into politics by Edna Healey. Roy Jenkins, had an aristocratic drawl and an inability to pronounce his R's, but he was the best parliamentary speaker of his generation, able to sway the Commons by a combination of Celtic passion and skillfully deployed argument. And I was certainly captivated by his charm, admired his very elegant style, and later was impressed by his political courage and his European commitment. Dennis was somewhat different, with his bushy eyebrows and florid complexion. He was certainly earthier than either Jenkins or Crosland, but he possessed the most enormous zest for life and one of the finest brains in British public life, which enabled him to master the complexities of defence and economic policy. Tony Crosland had good looks and simply oozed self-confidence, at any rate publicly. I was attracted by his intellectual glamour, by the insouciance at which he sported his brightly coloured braces, somewhat rather better than these ones here, and his remarkable attachment, and romantic attachment, I think it probably was, to Grimsby, the East Coast fishing port that he represented in Parliament. Above all, his writings, especially the revisionist masterpiece, which we've been talking about, The Future of Socialism, and the follow-up book, which is perhaps not so widely known today, The Conservative Enemy, helped shape my whole approach to politics. And I think it's difficult to exaggerate the impact of The Future of Socialism when it was first published 60 years ago. For mainstream MPs and activists, it provided a guide in the post-Attlee era. While the Labour left swiftly recognised the challenge that Crossandite revisionism posed or presented to Clause 4 socialism. For my generation, The Future of Socialism was, I think, a revelation. We warmly welcomed its distinction between ends and means, its emphasis on social justice and equality rather than nationalization, its insistence on the need to revise policies in the light of changing circumstances, its stress on power, not for its own sake, but in order to implement progressive programs, and its call for a one-nation party embracing all sections of the community. In other words, as Crosland wrote in The Conservative Enemy, a broadly based national people's party. Well, we need that, certainly, at the moment. For much of the 60s, if I had been asked to choose a leader from my three political heroes, it would have been Tony Crosland. He was the driving force behind the Campaign for Democratic Socialism, the Gaitskellite grouping. And in Parliament, he was one of the few front benchers who sounded as authoritative in opposition as in government, in opposition when he didn't have the support of civil servants. Just mind you, he was so lucky he had David Lipsey. And in Wilson's first government, he was an exceptionally creative education secretary, and I was surprised you didn't mention this, David, because I think it's his best claim to fame as a minister, who spearheaded the comprehensive revolution in secondary education. I know it has been much criticized since, but I think we underestimate his achievement there. Now, fast forwarding to the Labour leadership election of 1976, as Dick was talking about, I think Dick was one of the people who'd approached me to say, was I voting for Tony? Sort of feeling he was. When Jenkins, Crosland, Healey, all threw their hats in the ring. And so far from winning, Crosland finished bottom with a derisory 17 votes out of 314. I mean, that's a pretty bad performance. What had gone wrong? The first obvious point was that the three modernizing candidates were competing against each other. In fact, of course, their combined vote was 19 votes more than the total obtained by the winner, James Callaghan. But with all three running, none of them had a chance. There wasn't a hope of them winning. So much for political rivalry. Indeed, I wrote a whole book, really, about that. I think it was quite disastrous for them and, indeed, for the Labour Party. In any case, Crosland had fallen behind Jenkins and Healey. In November 67, when Jim Callaghan resigned as Chancellor following devaluation, Wilson chose Jenkins rather than Crosland, which was a tremendous blow personally to Crosland, and indeed harmed the relationship, perhaps forever, between Jenkins and Crosland. Although, of course, Crosland was the superior as an economist. This was partly because Harold Wilson got on much better with Roy Jenkins. They could both discuss the Victorian railway system, which seemed rather an odd thing to discuss between two modernizing socialists, but that's what they did. Whereas I think Harold was a bit frightened of Tony, and he didn't quite know what Tony would say to him. And partly, of course, the other reason was that Roy Jenkins was so effective in the House of Commons, so at a very difficult time for the Labour Party, Roy was likely to be able to persuade people better than Tony. That's what Harold thought, at any rate. Then, of course, in 1972, when Jenkins resigns as Shadow Chancellor over the European referendum issue, Wilson appointed Healey, who knew absolutely nothing, as he admitted himself, about economics. But, of course, he was much the most prominent personality of the two. So Crosland had lost out twice for one of the top positions from which he could have possibly mounted a serious challenge for the leadership. And by the time Callaghan appointed him foreign secretary, it was too late. Of course, Tony Crosland died within a year. And a third point, I think we should remember that Crosland was actually one of the losers over the European issue. Although Jenkins's chances of succeeding Wilson disappeared with his resignation in 1972, Crosland also lost out. And this was partly because of his cautious, non-committal approach. He dithered and then abstained. And this disappointed very profoundly most of the pro-European MPs. And of course, but he didn't, by his actions, win any fresh adherence from the antis. So Crosland didn't have a firm basis of support in the PLP. And if I could just end off by saying this, which is my own view on Crosland, because when I was asked, I might have been by Dick, I didn't vote for Tony in 1976, and I supported Roy Jenkins on the first ballot. I'm not sure whether I'm proud of that now. And then Jim Callaghan on subsequent further ballots. In 1980, just to get my voting record on the public, I voted and worked for Dennis Healey, as I did in the subsequent deputy leadership election of 1981, when I was one of his co-managers, which he actually managed to win by a whisker or an eyebrow, as he said. To his death, however, I did remain a firm admirer of Tony Crosland, and I was deeply saddened when he died. But like David, I'm not sure that despite his outstanding ability, he would have actually made a good PM. I think perhaps he became more indecisive as he grew older. Might have been something to do with his health, I don't know. And I think he became very slow to make up his mind. He had to have so many working parties and seminars and so on. But you can't do that if you're Prime Minister. At least I understand you can't do it. And I think it was his role as socialist writer and theoretician, as somebody in your book said, Labour's scholar politician par excellence, which made the most impact on me and I think on other people as well. But even now, if you reread The Future of Socialism, and I've got my original copy here, if you read it 16 years later, the brilliance and sharpness of Crosland's mind stands out. And though the policy details may have not be relevant at all, the distinction that he drew between ends and ends is so insistent, is so important. This is not a wind coming up. The insistence on revising policies in the light of changing circumstances. The stress on power as a means to implement programs is not something wicked, it's something you have to have if you're going to do any good. All these are essential points today and will be essential for any party if we are to survive as a successful force in British politics. And if I'm asked, as I sometimes still am, what is my political position, I have no hesitation in defining myself as a revisionist in the Crosslandite mold.
Ask each of you just to comment very, very briefly on one of the features in Patrick's book, in which he says that Crosland has a sort of, one of the important places to go back to Crosland is that he has a sort of ethical view of equality. I mean, it seems to me that Crosland very much falls actually outside the, he's a much more convivial, sociable socialist, unlike Gaitskell. He was a technocrat. There is something moral there about who it is you think you're on the side of, which I think Crosland has a decisively different position actually from Gaitskell, because Gaitskell thought if you got the widgets right, it would probably be all right. Whereas I think Crosland had a feeling. So where did that, in your personal experience, where did that belief in equality, where did it come from and where did it go?
Well, I think it was largely his family background, which was they were Plymouth Brethren of a rather exclusive sector in the Plymouth Brethren movement. Both his father and his uncle, who were very senior civil servants, refused knighthoods because they believed in equality. And though Tony decisively rejected the religious teachings of his his family, this idea that a passionate belief in human equality, and that you had to make moral decisions rather than convenient ones in life, carried over into his politics. So I think that was the basis of it. Additionally, that he was, who were his political exemplars? He was a tremendous admirer of Edward Bernstein, the revisionist Marxist leader of fiber, of not fiber, villamine, Germany. And he, in fact, when he was still, I think, 19, he wrote a letter to his great friend Philip Williams, saying he was going to be the British Burnside, and that was the seed of future of socialists, though he didn't actually write it to about 15 years later. So that's the best explanation I can give.
Thank you very much. David, if you think that's an appropriate question.
Yeah, I do. I totally agree with Dick's explanation of it. I think I would draw out one thing about Crosland's egalitarianism, and that is that it wasn't confined to equality of opportunity, which is what so much egalitarianism is confined to today. It was both a belief that not only should everybody have an equal chance of winning prizes, but the prizes for the best should big, for the rich should be less big, and for the poor should be bigger. And also, and perhaps even more, and this relates to your ethical side of it, a belief that the real horror of society was to do with social divide and the inability of people to talk one-to-one like normal human beings. Yeah. I mean, we must remember this was a time when society was actually highly divided by social class. It wasn't just a sort of advertiser's shorthand. Nobody called people like us by our Christian names, as it were, Giles, as members of the House, you know, this sort of thing. And that has very largely disappeared, and much of what Crosland thought of as an ethical good society, in fact, has resulted, you know, open-air cafes he was much in favour of, end of restrictions on drinking hours, if you can understand that. But a society of freer intercourse between equal human beings who were relating to each other on equal terms. That was the ethical heart of it.
Thank you. Giles.
Gene, I'm not going to defend Gate School, but I think you've got him wrong, frankly. you perhaps will get a book about that later. I think he and Crosland shared a very strong view in the need for a classless society. And both of them thought it was, as David said, it was where you had to break down barriers, and the barriers of class were particularly important. Gate School taught miners in Nottingham. Tony, during the war, you know, talked to his platoon and battalion and so on, and met people but he probably hadn't met before properly. And then, of course, fighting as a Labour MP, particularly Grimsby, this was very, very important that he could communicate. After all, it's not just that Tony went, was in, you know, the Plymouth, was it Plymouth Brethren?
Yeah.
Part of that. I mean, what he went to a public school, and it's, at that time, it was particularly inhibiting to talk to ordinary people if you went to a public school. And Tony, I think, instinctively inside himself wanted to break down that barrier. And I understand that. And Gate School was very much the same. So I think breaking down the barriers of class, and that's why he's so interested in education, that's why he's so interested in sociology. This is the clue to Diamond. Sorry, not, well, it is the clue to Diamond too, but to Crosland and indeed to Gate School.
Thank you very much. Let's take some questions. Do people need microphones, or can they just punt it? They can punt it. Fine. Perhaps I'll take a couple of questions. I'll take three questions in a go. So, one, two, three. If you could say who you are and ask a question. Yeah. Oh, stand up and shout and say who you are, and be brief.
Do they want one of these?
Yes, do you want one of these?
No.
Just shout. Turn around and shout.
Somewhere that, not surprisingly, that when he was much younger, he was conservatively extremely attractive to women and actually enjoy the company, well brought up young ladies. And the other point is, in his war record, he was in Yugoslavia at the end of the war, and there was a forcible repatriation.
Yeah.
Very much. If you could be brief.
Thank you. John Hume, my question is, had Tony Crosland lived a few more years, could he have prevented the STP?
Right. Thank you very much. And there was somebody in, yes, thank you.
Yes, thank you. Stuart Maxwell. Two brief questions that may or may not be related. One, it came across very clearly that
thank you very much, Dick.
Well, I won't try and answer all the points, just two or three. First of all, Tony's attitude to women. When I first knew him, he was going through a very bad state in his life. His first marriage broke down very quickly. I'm afraid it was a case of sexual attraction overtaking virtually everything else. They have very little in common. And the marriage didn't last very long. But I think he was very affected by the breakdown of this. He went through a very bad stage. When I knew him later, despite what David had said about him drinking, was it 3 or 4 glasses of gin beforehand, he was not a heavy drinker, but during this period, basically between his two marriages, he drank much too much whiskey. He was the worst for wear, not on a George Brown level, but he did a lot of womanizing at this time. When he and Susan got together, which must have been about, well, it was just after Future Socialism, Susan recounts in the afterword to the revised centenary edition, which I edited in 1956. She thought that he was a hopeless libertine and that she would have to put up with a great deal of carousing. But that proved not to be the case, rather to her surprise. That was a very good marriage indeed. She had an extraordinarily good effect on him, sobered him up, and I think his whole lifestyle was much more focused and concentrated afterwards. The question would have been able to stop the SDP if he had lived. I think it's almost certain he would not have joined it. I think had he remained in the Labour Party, it would have kept quite a lot of people in who otherwise jumped ship. Now, an interesting thing, this night in Brussels, when Roy Jenkins came to dinner with us, was between the two rounds of the leadership election in which Dennis Healey lost to Michael Foot. And between these two rounds, he was very anxious to know, because he thought I was some sort of election expert. I dabbled in that sort of thing at that time, what my view was. And in the first round, Dennis Healey was leading, but people had expected him to lead by about 20 votes, and he only led by about 12. And I said to Roy that I thought that Michael Foot was aged on the last thing, but he indeed did. And Roy was delighted to hear this. I mean, he didn't put it in as many words, but he clearly thought that launching the SDP on the basis that the Labour Party had fallen in quite irresponsible left-wing hands just wouldn't go if Dennis was the leader. But I think if Dennis had been elected, there would have been no SDP. And I mean, if Tony was still alive, if by any chance he'd been elected, there would have been no SDP. The SDP was born from the fact that the party was already swinging very sharply left, and that Michael Foot was elected leader rather than Dennis Healey. It's possible that if Dennis had been elected leader, that there might have been problems later on. But I do not think it would have been viable to launch the SDP in the spring of 1981, was it? If Dennis had been elected leader.
Thank you very much. David, SDP?
Well, I mean, I think I want to say is that the SDP and Europe for Tony became linked.
Yeah.
You know, don't forget, in his early years, he was at least a stronger pro-European as Roy,
conservative
Dennis, who wasn't very strong. He was a strong pro-European. But he came to associate that with a whole set of attitudes that he would have come to associate with the SDP, which was what he would take a view as an excessive liberalism, that's to say, worrying more about human rights in the Gambia, say, than in the realities of working class lives in Britain, that he came to regard as a certain sort of social snobbery and departure from the real world. So these two sort of coalesced in the Crosland Line. There is no possibility, I think, that he would have joined the SDP. He would have found it very painful, but he wouldn't have joined the SDP, nor would he have prevented the STB from being founded. And indeed, there was a profound difference, because nearly everybody in the SDP, Dick, was a strong European. That was the single characteristic that united them, and Tony by then wasn't.
Giles?
No, I don't have very much to say, except I think with Healey and Crosland staying inside the party, that would have been incredibly strong, and it would have made it SDP very unlikely to have really got off the ground.
Great. Another line of questions. I'll do it. One at the back, one on that side. And you. Okay, 1, 2, 3, sorry, just say.
John Barrett, and I actually come from Grimsby. I just wanted to ask you, I mean, you've spoken about equality as to why Tony Crosland went for the grammar schools rather than the public schools. Just wondered if you could explain
that. Let me just take the questions, because then, and there was somebody over there. I can't remember who it was.
Can I have a first shot at that?
Yeah.
Nick Bozenkett.
Yeah. And
not true.
It's bizarre.
No. Okay, and third question? I don't know who wants to jump in on those.
Can I have a shot at first two? Why did he go for grammar schools rather than private schools? I mean, the fact is he wrote a very good piece about private schools in The Conservative Enemy. I mean, he was disinterested in that. He wasn't at all. I mean, I think the fact it was more difficult to deal with it. And he set up, as many politicians do, he set up a committee to look at it. There was already, it was Labour Party policy, comprehensive secondary education, Labour Party policy. His predecessor's education minister had already started the process going. And Tony took it over and though he was not able to set up more comprehensive schools and get rid of more grammar schools than Mrs. Thatcher, he did, in fact, really get the revolution going. And I'm unrepentant arguer that this was the right thing to do at that particular time, because the 11 plus was acting as a deterrent to aspiration and ambition, quite contrary to what's argued these days. And you needed another vehicle. And this is what was happening, for example, in Sweden. He takes the Swedish model, and indeed in American schools at the time. And so that was why he became very interested in comprehensives. Now, just, I don't agree, Nicholas, that Crosland was anti-market. I mean, he was an economist. He believed in the market, and he thought the market was necessary. I think the formula which is used by the SPD that planning where necessary, market where otherwise, something of that nature. I mean, I think he would accept that sort of approach. And I always, when reading through his book, I mean, I didn't get the impression he was against it. On the contrary, I think he wasn't at all. It just was actually more difficult to change the Labour Party than it was to change the SPD. As you know, when Gaitskell tried, he failed. He didn't try very effectively, but it took, I mean, It was Tony Blair who revised Clause 4. It wasn't, but Crosland and Jenkins supported Gaitskell in his attempt to do it, which failed.
David.
Well, just to deal with the market, I mean, I agree with Giles. First of all, he was a Keynesian, so he wanted an expanding expansion from the centre through fiscal policy, but that didn't mean he wanted to take it. In fact, it was he who coined the phrase of one manifesto, are we going to propose that the co-op takes over Marx and Spencer as a sharp sign of what was totally meant? Now, I mean, you know, it has to put it in historic context. In those days, I remember when I was at school, pamphlets by the Institute for Economic Affairs, pro-market pamphlets, were a tiny little corner of a bookshelf, and you used to laugh at them because they were so mad. We didn't know that we were going to take over the country later on. But the idea that Crosland was anti-market is not true. It just simply, when there was a bit of the debate that hadn't even started then. Kissinger is a very interesting question because he clearly didn't have an ideological problem with Kissinger in the same, you know, as we know, there's a big anti-Kissinger school to which he would not have belonged. You have to think a bit about intellectual origins there because Tony had come up through, as it turned out, Americans and CIA funded pro-American anti-communist wing, which was incorporated in Counter magazine and some of the other things that they did. He wrote for them. He was as strong an anti-communist as, say, John Foster Dulles or Kissinger. He was also beguiled, seduced, if you like, by Kissinger's, you know, he didn't very often meet somebody who was as clever or cleverer than him and who knew more about the subject they were talking about than him. So he found this extremely beguiling. And I think the moral side of Kissinger, to which there is more than one side to the argument anyway, did not come out in the rather short period they knew each other, which is about 8 months, I should think, as strongly as it might have done with longer association.
Thank you very much. Any more questions? Another last round of questions. We've got lots of hands. One. Anybody else? We've got lots. Two. Okay, one, two. Thank you very much.
You mentioned about Tony Crosland's relationship with Howard Wilson. You haven't mentioned anything about his relationship with Hugh Callahan, who ended up providing him his greatest opportunity. I would appreciate your views on that relationship.
You should answer that.
You should answer that.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant.
Good one.
Well, really on Jim Callahan, he went back a long way with Tony. I remember Jim may have said this in the speech which he gave in tribute to Tony after he died, but when Tony was still a fellow in Oxford and teaching economics at Trinity College, Jim Callahan went down. I don't know if he went to speak to the Labour Club or what, but anyway, he was entertained by Tony Crosland, and it was immensely impressed by him, apparently, and went to Tony's room for a chat with him afterwards. Tony made it quite clear to Callahan that he was ambitious of going into the House of Commons. And Jim was absolutely amazed. He said, you've got this lovely thing here. Everyone looks up to you. Why do you want to do this? So he registered very early Tony's ability and his ambition. Now, when Hugh Gaitskill died, most of his strongest supporters wanted to back George Brown as his successor, though there were quite a number of reservations about his personal habits, particularly his drinking. Roy Jenkins in particular was a very strong supporter of George Brown. Now, Tony, what he said at the time was, we got a choice between a crook, meaning Wilson, and a drunk, meaning Brown. And he organised, along with Douglas Jay, a campaign to support Jim Callahan instead. Now, Jim got a respectable came easily third and was eliminated. But I think he remained extremely grateful. And, you know, this moved Callahan up to just another sort of still junior ex-minister, yeah, to one of the leading figures in the party. So I think that was why when he became prime minister, the choice for foreign secretary was between him and Roy, who desperately wanted to be foreign secretary. He had in his pocket an invitation to become president of the European Commission, but he hadn't accepted this and made it absolutely clear that his preference would be to go on as foreign secretary. Now, Tony had absolutely no aspiration to be foreign secretary, had not been particularly interested in foreign affairs at any time, so he was rather cool about it, whereas Aldous, who I was going to say worshipped him, who supported Tony, thought it was marvellous because it would push him up to the top echelon. But I think the other side of this was Callahan's relationship with Roy, which was very bad, particularly dating from the in place of not in place of fear, in place of strife. Yeah, when Jenkins had supported Barbara Castle, and that Callahan had led the opposition and led to the dropping of this. So, and also the fact that Callahan had turned out to be a very conservative Home Secretary, whereas Roy was a very liberal one. So it may have been partly because he admired and had affection for Tony, and partly possibly anyone but Roy. And Tony was the most senior of anyone with his back, Roy, and that was why he backed him, I think.
Can I, Giles, very quick answer, would he like to be an MP now and would he have been selected? And would you?
Oh, would I? Were you an MP?
No, of course.
No, but I mean...
But I'm not a great man, I wasn't an MP either.
No. I mean, the implication of would you is that somebody like Roy or Tony or Dennis, wouldn't be effective MPs. I mean, the fact is, they would be extremely effective.
No, the question was, really, would some
would he like to be?
Want to engage their life energy in that job?
Well, if it was the only way to get into Parliament, yes, of course they would. I mean, that's about a job of being a representative MP. Was slightly different from now.
It was very different. It wasn't a 24/7, 365 days a week job. And my question was, would Crosland, Healey and Jenkins would have wanted to do it? And secondly, would they have been prepared to have gone through all the selection processes?
Could I have a go at this?
I'm just going to end the very last point. The party members would have chosen them if they had had some time to organise for their own position. If they were thrown just now into what the situation is now, it would be more. Of course, it'd be very difficult. But if they're very able people. I mean, if they were in this room now, they would dominate the room in a way that I don't believe most MPs do. They are terrific guys. I mean, that's very important to get across. And they won their constituencies because they were good, and they held on. I mean, Crosland was a very assiduous MP, all right, by the standards of then, but he did all the what was necessary. I mean, I was an extremely assiduous MP, frankly, because I had to be, because I came from outside. I mean, you adapt yourself to the situation. If you want to be in politics, then you've got to do what the job, what is required then as now.
David, last word.
He wouldn't have enjoyed it because the change is so huge. I mean, we used to think that if we got 30 letters a week to Tony Crosland, that was a heavy post pack. And now you get 300 emails a day. When he was up for selection in Grimsby, they asked him how often he intended to visit the constituency. And he said, well, once a month. And they said, that's marvellous, Mr. Crosland. Your predecessor, Kenneth Younger, a distinguished Labour minister, used to come up once a year on Boxing Day. And Kenneth would go up once a year on Boxing Day. He would visit three tobacconists in town and make sure he was seen, and he'd come back to London, and that was the last they saw of him. So it certainly would have been a wholly different life, and I doubt if he'd have found it a very agreeable one. So far as selection is concerned, I mean, there are two sides to that. If you look at what happened to him after he lost South East Gloucestershire, was it?
South Gloucestershire.
South Gloucestershire. He then set off to find a constituency, and it was extremely difficult. And it was only when Kenneth Younger came in to tell Hugh Gates that he decided to stand down, and Hugh Gates said, "That's marvellous, Mr. Younger, Crosland can have your seat," that this logjam was broken. But he worked bloody hard in a number of constituencies to try to get a seat.
And he only won, actually, the election.
He only won
192 votes. Yeah.
So, you know, he fought very hard for the job. I think lots of features of it he would have not been very, of the modern job, he would not have been very good at. For one thing, I don't think he'd have been good at reciting formulae on the media day and night. And, you know, it is now a completely different job than it was when I started working for him in 1974, utterly changed. Some ways for the better and in some ways not.
I'd very much like to thank this incredible panel for the real insights they've given us to politics and to Crosland. So thank you very much indeed.